Louise Jett, leader in training. She will be speaking on Seeking My Karass, How Kurt Vonnegut Introduced Me to Humanism.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm so happy to be with you, my humanist congregation, this morning. At an early age, I searched for a deeper meaning, which led me to being a devout Christian in a family of atheists. I distinctly remember asking my mom where my great aunt Rosalie went when she died. Mom said something to the effect of, "Some people believe she went to heaven. Others think she's just gone." "What do we believe?" I asked in horror. "That she's just gone," Mom said. "But she'll live on in our memories." The thought of being just gone made me panic. There had to be more than to life than that, right? It was 1987, and at just 11 years old, I was facing my own mortality, and I became deeply religious. I started attending church on my own. I was the youngest due-paying member in my small-town Baptist church. I remember walking my dues down the church aisle and tucking my envelope in the steeple of a miniature church that served as a piggy bank of sorts for collections. My head was held high. I was feeling like an adult. I was a curious and studious congregation member. I read my Precious Moments Bible, well, religiously. And I asked a ton of questions. Lots of them were about dinosaurs. I was a pretty innocent 11-year-old, and I loved going to church, especially when there was music. In fact, I would perform solos and belt out hymns in all the local churches, which were, of course, all Christian. Old Rugged Cross was always my favorite, and I can still envision my little girl self belting out the cryptic words of the gospel song so sincerely, so seriously. I clung to that old rugged cross. The love I had for Jesus was powerful. I wanted to walk in love just like Jesus Christ. I even wrote him poetry. After singing at a local Pentecostal church and seeing them filled with what I thought was the Spirit of the Lord, I thought I had found my people. I find this notion ridiculous now, but I was totally mesmerized by their behavior. I admired their zealousness, and I very much wanted the Lord to fill me so that I could speak in tongues too. But it never happened for me because I wanted it to be real. It had to be real, and it simply is not. Eventually, I was literally expelled from the church during a service for quietly giggling with a toddler who was playing peekaboo with me in her frilly pink Sunday dress. The preacher stopped the sermon and told me to leave. He wasn't nice about it either. I remember walking down the row between the pews, but this time I felt like a pariah. My head was hung low. By the time I walked the short way home, I had become irate with the preacher, and all the doubts I had been repressing came bubbling up. At the time, I was devastated. I had devoted every Wednesday night and every Sunday morning to this church, and I no longer felt welcomed there. I spent 3 years of my short life as a part of this community, and not one person in the entire congregation had stood up for me or asked me to stay. Looking back, I realized the pastor was constantly frustrated with me, because even through all the indoctrination, I asked lots of questions, I refused to speak in tongues, and probably more importantly, I was never able to convince my parents to join the church. He pressured me to pressure them to join a lot. I could see so clearly the game he was playing. The jig was up. I was nearly 14 years old, and this experience led me to become an atheist. Shedding my religion was painful. I still felt a resounding love for people and nature, but I became overwhelmed with a sense of betrayal and hopelessness. Coupled with other devastating personal events, the loss of my faith sent me into a deep depression. The impermanence of life was maddening. The randomness of it all, it made no sense. Thankfully, I was an avid reader and artist. I would stay up all night reading, drawing, thinking. I also wrote a lot. I recall an essay published in my high school newspaper in which I compared Jesus to Santa Claus. The vice principal, normally not a fan of mine, called me into her office. She thanked me for writing the essay and said it made her reconsider the stories we tell ourselves and our children. Even though she didn't understand my atheism, she appreciated my insight. I don't remember how or why I picked up Kurt Vonnegut's novel, Breakfast of Champions, but I did. And it resonated with me completely. Even as a brooding teenager, I laughed out loud at Vonnegut's storytelling. He was speaking to me, and his words were like medicine for my soul. One of the main characters of the novel, a science fiction writer named Kilgore Trout, my mom had to talk me out of naming my son Kilgore, but Kilgore Trout thought his life was over for him and that he would never make a difference or live up to his full potential. He considered himself an artist who devoted his entire life to the search for truth and beauty, and he didn't find doodly squat. Those are his words. He felt that his life was pointless, and then he became a distinguished scholar in the field of mental health. What a noble thing to be. In a way, he ended up on top very late in his life. The loss of my faith had made me feel meaningless. I had searched for my Lord and Savior, but like Trout, I had found doodly squat. Still, the possibility of being impactful gave me hope. And for me, through various plot lines throughout the book, Vonnegut was presenting a clear message. Whatever the state of one's existence, accepting your circumstance is easier if unencumbered by fantasies of divine intervention. For example, at one point, Vonnegut presents himself to Trout as his creator in the book. He, as the author, writes himself into the book and he extends an apple to his creation. And Trout recognizes the apple as a symbol of knowledge, liability, and the consequences of discovery. And even after his newfound success and all the lessons he finally learned, he shrinks from the gift. And he wishes for youthful rejuvenation instead. He cries out, "Make me young, make me young, make me young." The first time I read this, I laughed out loud. Even as a teenager, I knew not even youth can save us from ourselves. Vonnegut, he understood this too. Youth doesn't protect us from our mythological archetypes. In fact, it is when we are young that myths are presented and perpetrated upon us. It is only when we are older that we can return to the experiences of our youth to enhance our understanding of the present. The novel gave me perspective. Even without life eternal, my life was worth living. Waiting on a savior was futile. I should instead empower myself with knowledge. If anyone was going to make a difference in my life, it was going to be me. There is so much more to the novel Breakfast of Champions. I highly encourage you to read it if you haven't already. The book served as a gateway for me, the first of many Vonnegut books I would devour, and each one was full of dark humor, humanism, kindness, criticism, and hope. Vonnegut reinforced my inclination to appreciate others despite their flaws, and he helped me accept my imperfections as well. When I started to research Vonnegut to learn more about him as a person, I discovered his connection to secular humanism. The American Humanist Association awarded him the Humanist of the Year Award in 1992, and he served as the AHA's honorary president from 1992 to 2007. Vonnegut came from a long line of free thinkers. They valued using their mind, senses, and body, and the best in human thinking to come to their own conclusions and develop their own moral codes. He once said in an interview, "My ancestors who came to the United States a little before the Civil War were atheists, so I'm not rebelling against organized religion." When asked if he thought organized religion can make anybody happier, he said, "Oh, of course. Lots of comforting lies are told in church, not enough, but some." He summed up his humanism in a famous quote you may have heard. He once wrote, "Humanists try to behave decently and honorably without any expectation of rewards or punishments in an afterlife. The creator of the universe has been unknown to us so far. We serve as well as we can to the highest abstraction of which we have some understanding, which is our community." While most of Vonnegut's novels focus on individuals, in one of my favorite books, Cat's Cradle, he stresses the importance of community by inventing an outlawed religion, Bokanonism. Bokanonists believe if you find your life tangled up with somebody else's life, for no very logical reasons, that person may be a member of your Karass. We find the people of our Karass by accident, but we stay with them by choice. Those people with which we share arbitrary connections, they're in what Vonnegut calls our grand falloon, a sort of false Karass. According to Bokanonism, examples of grand falloons would be any political party, business, or company, and any nation, anytime, anywhere. Talk about anti-nationalism. To Bokanonists, liking the same sports team or living in the same country is absolutely meaningless. As one of the Bokanonists says, "If you wish to study a grand falloon, just remove the skin of a toy balloon. Nothing's there." However, on the other hand, your Karass helps you cultivate meaning in your life. It is your team that helps you live your values while enriching your community. The Bokanonists call this doing God's will without ever discovering what you're doing. The first sentence in the books of Bokanon is this: "All of the true things I'm about to tell you are shameless lies." Vonnegut warns his readers, anyone unable to understand how a useful religion can be founded on lies will not understand this book either. But for me, I eventually would discover my religious humanism to be one founded in truth. And I found my Karass in ethical culture. All the previous churches had turned out to be grand falloons, and I turned out to be an ethical humanist. I had always been. I hadn't lost any religion. I had finally found mine. Because unlike Vonnegut, I wouldn't say my humanism is of a secular variety. And while a Bokanonism was unable to save the earth from destruction and Cat's Cradle, I honestly believe ethical humanism can. While all flavors of humanism affirm that human beings have the right and responsibility to give meaning and shape to their own lives, ethical humanism is clear about the essential role that ethical principles play in human relationships. As the American Ethical Union states, ethical societies serve as religious congregations in which members can build a community of friends, find inspiration and purpose, provide moral education for their children, celebrate seasons and life events, and clarify their worldviews. All of this without the comforting lies or belief in the supernatural. The more I became involved with ethical culture, the more I realized I had truly found my people. The members of our movement support me as I strive to live my values. And even without knowing who ethical culture founder Felix Adler was, I had pretty much always tried to behave in a way that elicited the best in others and myself. Ethical culture just gave me the words to express how I had always felt in my heart. Our core values spoke to my strong desire for social justice, and I could see how ethical action can make the world a more fair and just place for all people. The more I learned about ethical culture, the more I realized I want to be a leader, with a capital L. A professional ethical culture leader. Leaders fill the roles of religious clergy within the ethical culture movement. They meet the pastoral needs of members, perform ceremonies, and serve as spokespeople for their congregations. I want to help spread humanistic values throughout space and time, connecting others with resources, information, and the support they need, not only to live meaningful lives, but also to further the growth of ethical humanism. I appreciate that in order to be a humanist, that I do not have to embrace comforting lies. I appreciate that each of us creates our own flavor of humanism. I am not forced to behave according to dogma. I can be accepting of all faiths and none. And I can be appreciative of all the ways of living that do not infringe on the rights of others. There is no one right way to live. And I understand that we are stronger together. As a leader, I want to meet people on common ground and build communities of support and love through inclusion and communication. I truly love people, even the difficult ones, even the ones I don't agree with. Although it can be an unpopular opinion, I truly believe everyone deserves to be treated fairly and kindly. And I truly believe that I can learn from everyone. I speak to you today as a leader in training who is grateful to the National Leader Council and the American Ethical Union for acceptance into the training program. Sometimes I envision myself serving as a leader of an ethical society or as a humanist chaplain at a college, as long as I'm playing a role instrumental in the spreading of ethical culture, and as long as I am safeguarding its future, I will be happy. Vonnegut once said of the American Humanist Association, that we have an organization, a boring business, is to let others know we are numerous. We would prefer to live our lives as humanists and not talk about it or think more about it than we think about breathing. But we have to talk about it. We have to talk about humanism. It is too important not to. Sharing our humanism could be transformative for our world. I believe as ethical humanists, we should express our beliefs and live our values out loud. We should lead by example and publicly proclaim our humanism. Representation is so important. What if Vonnegut hadn't identified as a humanist? What if the AHA didn't recognize him as a humanist of the year? Would I have discovered or explored the life stance on my own? I honestly don't know. I do know that I'm grateful for Vonnegut. Even though his humanism didn't exactly look like mine, I appreciate all the other humanists, known and unknown, dead and living, who trust the best in human thinking while actively living their values. These are my people. My Karass, so to speak. We are focused on justice, equity, and equality. Even though we may have different opinions on how to get there, in fact, it is our diversity that strengthens us. I remain optimistic about our potential and open to the endless possibilities the future may hold for our movement and our global community. I honestly do. Thank you so much for listening. I look forward to further exploring this topic with you at the end of platform.
Thank you, Louise. We are not passing collection baskets right now, but if you're moved to donate, to make a donation today, you can do so at ethicalsdl.org/donate. But don't feel you have to. We recognize that this is a difficult time financially for many people. For those in the auditorium today and for those at home, we have a huge book sale, and all the books on the book carts, both adult and children's books, CDs and DVDs, and the books on the shelves in the hall by the name tags, with the exception of the opera media, are pay what you want. You can pay in the Dropbox on the book cart, or you can pay Kent or Joellen for it.